With this session update, I'm Shannon Lurkey. Flanked by a number of correctional officers, House Majority Leader Ryan Winkler and Senator Ron Latz promoted a bill that would ban the state from housing inmates in facilities not owned and operated by the state. Here's that media event.
Yes, we do. Good afternoon. My name is Ryan Winkler. I am the Majority Leader of the Minnesota House, and I'm here with my state senator, Ron Latz, Senator Bigham, and with Tim Henderson. We are here today in support of House File 1237, built to ban private prisons in Minnesota. Our criminal justice system is a core responsibility of government. Minnesotans deserve a strong public safety, and private prisons deserve strong public safety, and private prisons deliver worse outcomes for more money and are completely opposite of what a strong public safety system should be. We should be about taking care of the people who are doing the work in our prisons, the corrections officers who are here with us today, who put their professional commitment towards rehabilitation, corrections, and safety in our prison system. That is the record of public prisons and jails in Minnesota, and that is what we will continue to do as a legislature. We are not going to go down the path of private prisons, which put profits in front of public safety. And so we had a hearing this morning in the Corrections Division of Public Safety in the House. There was no opposition to the bill on the committee. Both sides were in favor of it. And I think this creates a real possibility that we can move forward with this legislation this year. And so, Senator Latz, I'll let you go.
Thank you. And I'm glad to be here with my state rep, Representative Winkler, as well as my colleague from the Senate, Senator Bigham, and Mr. Henderson, and all of these fine people around us who daily they put their lives at risk to take care of the toughest people that are in society. That we don't want outliving on our communities, or many of whom have committed heinous crimes, and others who have done things which they are getting accountability for. And the best way to make sure that they are safe and our staff are safe is to have the public purpose as our top purpose in the administration of our correctional facilities. When profits are the number one goal of operating a business, corners get cut, and it's easy to cut corners in the correctional system if that's your motivation. And we've seen the effect of that around the country in other states where they've had private prisons. The fact is they're not safer. They are less safe for the correctional officers as well as for the inmates. They don't deliver the kind of services that a correctional system should. I mean, by name, in Minnesota, we are aptly called a correctional system because a primary goal of our system is to correct bad behavior, to give our inmates, 95% of whom will move back into our community sometime, the tools to be successful and not commit new crimes when they come out. And that means chemical dependency treatment, that means sexual offender treatment, that means other programming to help them get their GEDs or college degrees while they're in prison, make productive use of their time, and other work skills so when they come out, they can get a job, they can be taxpayers, they can be part of our community. We need those skilled people watching them and helping them to accomplish those goals while they are in prison. And the correctional officers that are surrounding us today are exactly the kind of people that we need to do that. Our public goal is for everyone to be safe. We know private prisons don't accomplish that anywhere near as well as the public systems do. And I agree with Representative Winkler. To me, there is nothing more quintessential as a core function of government than not only convicting those who've committed crimes, but then imprisoning them, taking care of them, watching them, protecting the public from them, and preparing them for when they go back into the community. That's our job. Profits should not get in the way of that. So with that, I'd like to introduce Tim Henderson from AFSCME, who represents these correctional officers in their union.
Well, thank you. So on behalf of all of AFSCME Council 5, specifically the men and women in uniform and that work in all of our prisons, we want to thank Senator Latz and Representative Winkler for authoring what we consider to be responsible and moral legislation. It's time to end the concept that anybody should profit off of incarcerating human beings. It's deplorable, it's despicable, and CoreCivic is a company that we do not want to partner with, and we never want them in the state of Minnesota. So once again, thank you. on behalf of all of us.
We'll be happy to take any questions.
Is this action considered kind of preemptive, or is this in response to an increase in interest from private prison corporations? I know that the Appleton facility is no longer in current operation, but is there any revival of activism from the from the private prison lobby?
Tim, do you have any information on that, or Ron?
I haven't been contacted by the private prison lobby, and no.
Well, they do have lobbyists in Minnesota, and they most certainly would pursue this option if it were available. In fact, there's a proposal that I think would cost $180 million to upgrade the facility and have the Department of Corrections lease it. And, you know, so they are not going quietly. And I think this legislation is essential to make sure that we don't continue to investigate and go down this path. We need to have a system. We need to have adequate staffing, and we need to have enough correctional officers in the prisons that we have. We need to make sure that the people who are working in the jails, or I mean the prisons on corrections and rehabilitation, are safe and that they're able to do this work. It is a civil liberties and a equal rights issue. It is an issue of safety. We have certainly, we do not want to lose another officer because of unsafe conditions in our private or in our public prisons, and we do not need to continue this path of looking at a private for-profit option in Minnesota. We need to do a better job of what we have already and not continue to think about this path.
The other concern, I think, is that when you've got space available, like a gas, it tends to expand to fill the space that's available in the room. And we, and I know Senator Chairman Limmer shares this concern about not doing anything that unnecessarily expands the criminal, the population that needs imprisonment. When you have a private facility available, when that option is still on the table, even being discussed, it's easier to say, fine, we'll increase penalties, we'll create new crimes, and so on. When the movement across the country and in Minnesota is in the opposite direction. The movement is to make sure that we incarcerate the people that need to be incarcerated to protect the public safety. And for those who don't, then we don't need to put them in prisons. And as long as Appleton is still sitting out there as a theoretical option, there's going to be pressure from CoreCivic and others to come in and fill that space. It's uneconomic. The Department of Corrections did a study a couple of years ago on this and determined it just doesn't make financial sense to go down that road either. If we end up needing more prison space because the population increases or the rate of crime increases, we've got the capacity within our existing system, and existing footprints, to build on to our current facilities that would not necessitate going into a whole new building.
Happen with that facility in Appleton, since it is there, ideally?
Well, I don't know how you repurpose a facility like that. My guess is right now it's being used for federal incarceration. I don't know if, in fact, it's even being used at all right now. But it's a building that's kind of designed for a unique purpose. So I don't know. Maybe, you know, it was an economic development opportunity for Appleton many, many years ago. And maybe the space could be better used for something more productive, and I couldn't tell you what that is, though.
Senator Latz, there's not a Senate file listed here. Will there be a Senate file?
I would expect that there will be, yeah.
Are you going to file it?
I'll file it, yeah.
Have other states done this? Are you following a model that other states have banned private prisons?
Yes, several. I think Iowa, I can't remember the list, but it's multiple states have banned private prisons. And other states are pulling back away from them. And, you know, Tennessee, for example, is pulling further away from that. I think people are, the whole, you know, this is, what is like the one thing that Washington has successfully done in the last year? And that was to pass sentencing reform. The whole country recognizes that we went too far on tough on crime and that we need to reconsider our whole criminal justice system. And I think the recognition that having a for-profit company who has a financial incentive to lobby for tougher sentences, putting more people in prison so that they can make more money, is not a good situation to be in. And so in addition to the outcomes being worse, safety being an issue, we want to move away from incarcerating more people. And having private prisons doesn't help us make that change.
Has anyone here ever worked in a private prison? You can talk about what it was like.
I have.
Can you
If you're willing to, sure.
Please come on. Yeah, fine.
Can you tell them your name and answer the question?
Sure. I'm Officer William Farr from Lionel Lakes, and I used to work at Prairie Correctional Facility in Appleton, Minnesota. And my experience there, I worked there from 97 to 98, and then I took a little hiatus, and I was there from 2001 until I got laid off in 2009. My experience there was we were always running short as far as staff was concerned. There was a lot of forced overtime, which put a lot of pressure on me. It took a personal family toll on me because I was always at work. A lot of safety issues. That prison has a lot of blind spots, and they wouldn't do anything about it, even at the request of staff. When we asked for security mirrors, we asked for more cameras, they wouldn't give it to us. And they had this mentality there with the executive team that they know best. So we were just told we had to be robots and follow. And so it was not a very conducive or a very good workplace as far as that's concerned. It was not employee friendly at all, because their bottom line was it was about the money. And that's all they cared about, was what were they turning for a profit at the expense of us, not to mention the low wages. I did not have a livable wage when I worked there. I started at $11.57 an hour. That's not a livable wage in Minnesota, even in Western Minnesota, where housing is cheaper.
Did you have a sense that the Minnesota Department of Corrections had any oversight over what was happening there?
None at all, other than we were required to be ACA accredited, and we were. But even then, the files and stuff, the leadership there went through those files, and they made sure everything looked good on paper. But that wasn't necessarily what was happening.
Could you spell your last name for us, please?
P as in Paul, H-A-R-R.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Let's get support in the Senate. I think some senators would like to see the prison reopened and used as a private facility.
Well, you know, there were some political dynamics in past years involved in the efforts to reopen Appleton because of the contested campaigns and the challenges in that district. And I think that was part of the motivation that we saw in the past. I don't think that's the case this year. I haven't heard of anything about that. So I think we can focus on the merits of the case only. I don't know what kind of traction we'll get in the Senate. I was encouraged to learn about the House hearing this morning that there didn't seem to be any opposition to this. So perhaps we've found a bipartisan sweet spot this year in focusing on our public facilities. We have enough challenges taking care of our public facilities and diverting resources into the pocketbooks of private corporations. Taxpayer money into the pocketbooks of private corporations to accomplish the same thing that we can do publicly doesn't seem to me a wise use of funds, and it would be the kind of message that would resonate in all corners of the Capitol.
Can I ask this is not totally off topic, because I think there was some prison money in Capitol budget. Majority Leader, what attitude do you think House DFL will have toward doing a bonding bill this year, given the Senate's stated opposition to doing it this year?
Well, a bonding bill, like, as you know, requires Republican votes in the House, and it will require Democratic votes in the Senate. So bonding and taxes tend to be the linchpin at the close of session, and it requires a deal. And so certainly House Democrats are going to be aligned largely with Governor Walz on pursuing a robust bonding bill this year and next year. And I would imagine that that'll be part of our negotiations right down to the end. And, you know, on the corrections side, we're doing far more than bonding. We're also moving legislation to hire a lot more corrections officers and provide the support needed in our public prisons to make sure that we are safe and that we are rehabilitating people. And so bonding will be part of that. That will be, I would guess, kind of an end of the session negotiated item. I would see no reason why corrections-related items would not be part of it, however. I would expect that they would be.
I would just ahead of that, on the Senate side, I'm not involved heavily in the bonding, the capital investment process, but I know that people are spending resources, Republicans are spending their time and energy talking about capital investment projects as well. So no matter how this plays out, I don't think the Senate Republicans are going to want to be surprised and have to make decisions in the last 30 seconds of session about what to include, what not to include, if a final deal includes a bonding bill. And I will just add, you know, I'm carrying the bill in the Senate for the correctional officer additions. Senator Bigham is a strong supporter of that effort as well. He's put a lot of work in on that topic as well. And I think we're going to find bipartisan support, and I know that the majority is anticipating a substantial budget item to finally bring staffing levels up to where they ought to be, as close as we can, given the fact that we've got a low unemployment rate in Minnesota, and we've got to find the people to hire, too.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you for all your work.